good to know. Would you check your tobacco account? I think you may have made a slight error, $1 billion or so, but check it, would you?
I'm terribly sorry to disturb you, Mr. Silvercord, but there's a strange long-distance call. The man keeps saying, Il Sindaco per Signor Silvercord.
Sindaco? It'll be the mayor. Which line?
It's on your private line, Mr. Silvercord.
Pronto? Sindaco, buongiorno, che piacere, come sta? Quando è successo? Quando è il funerale? Ci sarò. Ci sarò. E grazie di avermi chiamato. Well, dear friend, you're with her now. Anne?
Yes, Mr. Silvercord?
Get me on the first plane tomorrow for Milan. And arrange for a car to meet the plane and take me to Città di Castello. Bella, bella, bella.
You haven't told me what brings you to Città di Castello. Or maybe you don't want to.
No, not at all. But my story goes back to before you were born. Or maybe you were in nappies or diapers.
The before you were born is just fine with me.
Well, you see, in World War II, it was we British who drove the enemy out of Città di Castello. It was then that a resistance fighter introduced us to the most unusual young woman you can possibly imagine.
What was his name?
Piedi. Vincenzo Piedi.
You mean Monsignor Piedi?
Yes. I mean Monsignor Vincenzo Piedi. Your family knew him?
Oh, everybody in this area knew him.
I wonder how many knew that he also served in World War I. And that he lost a lung in that great struggle. Just think. Lived a lifetime, well, more than 60 years, with one lung. Not so many of us get to that age with two lungs.
You said a lifetime like it was over.
Yes. His lifetime on this earth is over. But not his eternal lifetime. That's just beginning. For your information, that's where you're taking me. To his funeral. See that tower? The Church of St. Dominic. That's where we're going. Oh, hello. I'm glad to see you're with me. I hope I didn't bore you with that conversation with the driver. But I was so delighted to hear he was born in this area, I couldn't help reminiscing for a moment. And perhaps there are one or two things I should tell you before we go any further. Otherwise, you'll think I've lost my senses. This was Monsignor Piaggi's 87th year. It was he who introduced us, liberating forces, to Blessed Margaret of Castello. And I mean literally introduced us. You too are going to meet her any moment, because she's here in this church.
Yes,
that's right. She is one of the almost 200 uncorruptible bodies that exist. Knowing Margaret changed my whole life, from a small shop to a multinational. Whenever I had problems, and even to this day, I stop and think of Monsignor Piaggi's friend, Blessed Margaret, or Little Margaret, as he called her. I think of her, and the problems disappear in an instant. However, it's only fair to warn you that most of you won't believe this story, this true story, because it's almost incredible. The champion of Little Margaret. Now you've joined hands. Just up there.
the stairs.
Please, quiet!
Where are you taking her?
To the cloister.
They're taking her to the cloister!
Please, please, please. Professor Golding.
You can't let that go on like this.
Professor Golding.
Enough! Enough! Stop this sacrilege.
Thank you. Let us try and remain calm. Father Giovanni, why are you taking little Margaret to the cloister?
To bury her, of course.
Father, she should be buried here in the church where she belongs. Little Margaret is a saint.
There is no doubt that little Margaret was a holy person. She was indeed a very holy person, but as to whether or not she is a saint, is...
Let him finish, let him finish, and let's hear him out.
Thank you, Professor Golden, thank you. As to whether or not she is a saint, is a decision of the church. That decision belongs to the church. The church will investigate.
Investigation? How long will it take?
I'm sure. Why, St. Francis was canonized only 2 years after his death. And St. Anthony after only 1 year. Be patient, dear friends. Be patient.
Be patient, you say? Let me remind you that Rome has been investigating Albert the Great and Thomas Aquinas for over half a century. And they're still investigating. And let me tell you that both of them are saints just as surely as Paul is a saint. Before Rome gets around to investigating our little Margaret, we'll all be dead and buried. We citizens of Città di Castello know just as surely as we are here that our little Margaret is a saint. Stop this foolishness and bury her here where she belongs.
Yes!
In the church!
In this papal state called Massa Trebaria, the military leader, a young captain of the people, and his wife were expecting their first child, a boy, to be sure. The year was 1287, and all was in readiness to celebrate this grand occasion.
Your lordship. Your child is a girl.
What? A girl?
Yes. She is lame. And she is a hunchback.
What are you saying?
One leg is shorter than the other.
No. What kind of a god would do this to me? What kind of a god are you? God of love. God of mercy.
How is my wife?
She's fine, my lord.
I would like to see her.
And your little child, too.
No, no. I don't want to see the child. How could you? I don't know yet, but I do know we must keep her out of sight. No one must know.
She is so sickly looking.
Yes, that might do. For the time being, anyway. She's sick, and she'll probably die soon. I'll tell the servants to keep her in her quarters until we decide what to do. I'll spread the word that she's ill and won't survive.
It's Father Silvestro! Open the gate!
Maria, will you go to the nursery and see how the baby is? Father Silvestro, you're back.
Oh, Father, I've been waiting for your return.
I'm so glad you've come.
Oh, Father Silvestro, I'm so happy to see you.
And it's so good to see you, Lady Amelia, especially looking so well.
You're kind to say that.
And the child, how is she? I was told it's a girl.
Yes, a girl. But, Father...
The child is badly deformed, Father. We now believe she may be blind, too.
Deformed? I was told she's sickly and not expected to live.
She is so ugly. And the captain... Oh, Father, the captain is so angry.
May I see the child?
She's in the nursery.
She's not sick, just deformed.
Yes. As a matter of fact, she's got a strong pair of lungs.
Yes, I hear she has a strong pair of lungs. I'll put her back in the crib. Come. What name have you given her?
We haven't given her a name.
You're planning on a baptism, aren't you?
We haven't discussed that yet.
You haven't discussed that yet? That must be attended to right away. Take her to the cathedral at Mercatello as soon as possible. I'll prepare a letter to the bishop. You will see that it's done, won't you?
Certainly, Father. I'll make sure she's baptized.
What is the child's name?
I'm
sorry, Your Excellency, but Lady Amelia didn't give me a name.
Well, the child has to have a name, doesn't she?
Yes. Yes, of course, Your Excellency. Her name... Her name is Margaret.
Ah, Margaret. A blessing, a poem. Like a flower. Like a pearl. Margherita, abrenuncio te satine.
Abrenuncio.
Et omnibus operibus eus.
Abrenuncio.
Et omnibus pompius eus.
Abrenuncio.
Margherita, vis baptizari?
Vollo.
Margherita, ego te petitio, in nomine Patris, et Filii, et Spiritus Sancti. Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of salvation, and uphold me with thy free spirit.
When little Margaret was about 6 years old, she managed to elude her keepers and came face to face with a group of people looking for Father Silvestro's church. They had come into the castle seeking help. Well, she directed them to the church, and she was about to tell them who her mother was, when a nurse, her keeper, came screaming to her and took little Margaret away from the group of people. Margaret's father had witnessed the whole thing from a nearby door. It didn't take him long to make sure such a thing never happened again. He had the stonemason build a room beside Father Silvestro's church.
Here we are, Margaret's new quarters. Father Silvestro won't have to come to our quarters anymore because Margaret will be right here, safe and sound. Give me the key, Elkham, let me see what you've done. All right, let's get her up here.
Oh, thank you, my dear.
Hold on, little Margaret. You hold on. Hand her to me, Maria. There.
When Nini leaves, seal up the door. Well, that takes care of that problem. Come in. Father Silvestro, to what do I owe the pleasure of this visit?
I have just returned from Mercatello and been greeted with the news that little Margaret has been imprisoned in a room and the door sealed up. Is this true?
How was Mercatello?
I asked you a question.
Yes, I know you did. How was Mercatello?
Mercatello was fine. Is it true that you have sealed little Margaret away from society?
The child, Father, is a danger, not only to herself, but to others. So we have given her quarters where she will be safe. She is part of your church. An opening in the wall provides you with the opportunity to communicate with her.
You have treated her as if she had the plague.
Yes. Every bit as bad as the plague. Deformed, crippled, blind, ugly, she has no right to...
You. She has every right. She is a human being. She has a heart and soul just like you and me. Only hers is far more pure and loving than yours.
You have said quite enough, Father Silvestro. Be careful, or else.
Forgive me, Lord.
That's better.
I wasn't talking to you.
Little Margaret. Little Margaret. It's me, Father Silvestro.
Sister, are you at my window?
Yes, my child. I'm here. Oh, my child, my sweet Margaret. It's no wonder that you're crying your heart out. What have they done to you?
But, Father, that's not why I'm crying.
It's not?
No. Jesus was rejected by his people, and I've been rejected by mine. Don't you see what they've done?
No. I'm afraid I don't understand.
Why, they've given me the opportunity to live more like Jesus. And the reason I'm crying is because I'm afraid. I'm not going to be worthy of such an honor.
Oh, my child, my little Margaret, I've been such a fool. You're closer to Jesus than any of us. I assure you, you are worthy of the honor. Now dry your tears and go to sleep.
Are you sure, Father Silvestro?
I'm sure. I'm very sure.
I feel so much better. I won't cry anymore.
Good night, Margaret. Good night, little Margaret.
It's going to be cold out tonight, but you're going to be cozy and warm. Say, you're growing and getting stronger every year. Last year this time, these stones were only half as big, and you could hardly reach them.
Yes, Father, I think you're right.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake.
Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me.
Margaret, do you know what today is?
Yes, Father. It's Pentecost Sunday.
That's right. So I'll leave you with this thought. Jesus told his disciples to wait, to stay in their room and wait, and the Holy Spirit would descend on them. Then they were to go out and preach and teach and heal. And they waited. Oh, what a virtue to be patient.
I'll be patient, Father.
Yes, you are patient. And as they were eating, Jesus took bread, blessed it, and broke it, and gave it to the disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." Margaret, the body of Christ.
Father, how happy I am to see you. The most dreadful thing has just happened. Excuse me, but I must run and get Margaret some fresh clothes.
Well, just a minute. How about telling me what this dreadful thing is before you go running off?
Margaret has reached her puberty, and I haven't prepared her, poor child.
Oh, Nini, dear soul, I thought something dreadful had happened. All that has happened is that Margaret has received another grace from God.
I'll run and get some fresh things. You'll excuse me. I'll be right back.
Yes, yes, of course. You do that. But don't hurry back.
What is happening to me?
A wonderful thing. Just wonderful. God, dear little one, has given you, has given all women, a great gift. He has made it possible for you to help him bring new life into the world. Every month, Margaret, your body, in a special part called the womb, prepares itself to be the first home for a little child. Isn't that wonderful, Margaret, that you can be a mother?
Oh, Father, even though I'm blind and crippled, God works such a miracle in me.
God loves you, Margaret. He wants you to love and be loved.
Right now, though, more is needed. It takes time for everything to be ready for a child. Your body knows that the womb home isn't needed now. But every month, a new home will be prepared.
What happens to the old home?
Oh, that home dissolves. That's what's happening to you now. But there is more, Margaret. Jesus has shown us, taught us, that sometimes God calls a man or a woman to a special kind of motherhood or fatherhood.
This great love can be expressed in a very special way. You can make your loving heart home for all God's children. So you see, Margaret, there are two ways for you to be a mother. Now you must pray. Listen to God to see which mother he is calling you, his little pearl, to be.
Oh, Father, my heart, a home for all God's children. But I couldn't do that. Surely God wouldn't want to use me.
But Margaret, don't you talk with him? Don't you ask him?
I'll think about this, Father. I'll talk with Jesus to see what he wants me to do.
You know what today is?
It's the fourth day after the Sabbath.
And it's your birthday, Margaret. You're 17. Happy birthday, Margaret.
Oh, Father, you always remember. Why are you so kind to me? How I love you, dear Father Silvestro.
Enough. Now for the present I brought you.
You really brought me a present?
Now, don't get carried away. This is a very practical present. Here, put your hands out.
Now, this was a limb on a young tree, but now it's going to help you walk better and see better.
To walk better and to see better?
Yes, Margaret. Now, this is the top, and here, this is the bottom, the end that you put on the ground or the floor. As to walking, when you put your short leg forward, put as much of your weight as possible on the limb. No, wait. Let me finish. As to seeing, you can move it to make a path by moving it from side to side. And when your limb strikes something, you'll soon discover whether it is large or small, a solid object, or a human being.
Oh, Father, how thoughtful. Please, may I try it?
Sounding the warning of war.
Oh.
We're being invaded by Montefeltro, and I must go and see what I can do to help. You stay calm, and I'll be back with news for you shortly.
I'm telling you, you'll be much safer in Mercatello. Now, I want you to leave at once.
What about Margaret?
Margaret. You'll have to take her with you. We can't take the chance of enemy patrols finding her.
Oh, dear Jesus, war is so awful, and people get killed. Why do we have to have war? Why do people have to fight each other and kill each other? You say very plainly to love one another, not to fight one another. But if it must be, please protect my father. and this land we call home. Protect my mother and Ninny and Father Silvestro and all of my father's soldiers.
Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do.
Lady Amelia, the war is over. The captain has defeated Montefeltro.
And the captain, how is he?
He's safe. He's in the square. He'll be home soon.
Thank you, Mimi. Another interesting visitor some weeks past was a Franciscan father who told us about the most unusual goings-on in Città di Castello.
Città di Castello? Oh, yes, between here and Perugia.
Well, it seems that a Franciscan monk died. His name is Friar Giacomo, I think. And because of his healing power while he was alive, they made a shrine in the Franciscan church. And now it seems there are so many miracles taking place that you can hardly get near it.
But what has that to do with us? All very interesting, but I really don't understand.
Nothing really. Except I thought we might take Margaret over there. She's so religious, you know.
Margaret? Yes, of course. I'd forgotten she was still here. How is she?
The same. Always the same. I was thinking how wonderful it would be if she did receive some kind of miracle. Is Città di Castello very far?
About a day's journey, I believe. Yes. That's possible. As a matter of fact, I think that's a very good idea. I'll make the arrangements. We'll leave Thursday, early in the morning, before anyone gets up. And we should be in Città di Castello before sundown. You've done very well, my dear. I feel sure this trip is going to solve our problem, one way or the other. Daughter, you know where we are and why we're here. Now, I'm going to place you directly in front of Friar Giacomo's tomb. And I want you to pray like you've never prayed before.
Yes, Father.
Pray for a miracle. Well, if God will listen to all that rabble, he certainly will listen to important people like us.
Yes. Yes, of course he will.
Jesus, my Jesus, my Father on earth has asked me to pray for a miracle. I too would like to be made whole, but only, Lord, only if it is thy will. But I do pray for all those around me who are seeking your help. Help them, O Lord. Heal them of their suffering, for they know it only as pain to themselves, not as pain that brings them closer to you. Help them, O Lord. Help them.
Nothing has happened.
What are we going to do now? We can't just leave her here like this.
All right. If God won't resolve the situation, I will.
Oh, merciful Lord, if in your great wisdom you choose to leave me as I am, then I am content, Lord. But help my mother and father to understand and soothe their unhappiness, because I know I must be a great burden to them. Please look after Nini and Father Silvestro, and please let them know that I love them.
Child, little girl, please forgive me, but it's time to close the church.
Time to close the church? What time is it?
It's 7 o'clock. Everyone is gone except you.
Oh, I'm sorry. Please forgive me. Will you please help me to the door?
Certainly. How did you get here?
Should have came with someone.
Yes, oh yes. My parents brought me here. And they'll come back for me. Really, I thought they would have already come. But...
doesn't make any difference to you, does it?
No. I'll wait right here, if you don't mind.
Oh, sure. You wait right here.
But I have to lock the door.
You have to lock church door? Close it, yes. But lock it?
Oh, yes. Otherwise, the thieves would steal everything.
Steal? Steal from the church?
Oh, yes. Why, only last month, they stole the silver altar plate.
God forgive them, for they know not what they do.
Oh, they know, all right. Those plates were worth a lot of money. Well, I hope your parents come soon.
Bye.
Dear Lord, please look after my parents
and let nothing bad happen to them. And thank you for being here with me.
Look, while you were grumbling about getting up in the middle of the night, someone got here ahead of us.
How would that be?
Oh, must be a stranger. We'll just move him. Well, at least it's only one. And a little one at that. Hey, you. Wake up and move on. This place is taken. Look out, Roberto. He's got a club.
Hey, can you tell me what time it is?
Yeah. It's only a girl. It's about 6 o'clock in the morning, Thierry. What are you doing here?
I spent the night here because I'm a stranger and I don't know the streets. I was afraid to try and find the inn.
You alone?
No. My parents brought me. I'm afraid something's happened to them because they never came to get me.
Why didn't you go back by yourself?
I'm blind.
Where are you staying?
I don't know the name, but it's near here, because we walked here in a few minutes.
Oh, that'll be the Black Pearl. Come on, honey. We'll take you there and see what's the matter.
Oh, thank you. You're so very kind.
Now, what are you doing waking me? Get yourselves away from here!
Now, just a minute, young feller. Don't you be so hasty. Ever see this child before?
Yeah. She came in yesterday with her parents.
Well, don't just stand there. Go get them.
I can't. They're not here.
Not here?
No, they left about noon yesterday.
Why, them no good...
No. No, please don't say that. I love my parents. And I'm sure there is a reason. After all, I've been a burden to them all these years. It's about time I took care of myself.
Come on. Come on. Gather around. Now, this is Margaret. She was abandoned here yesterday by a couple of no good...
No. They are good. Please, don't say anything bad about my parents.
Ah, she was abandoned here yesterday by her loving parents. Now you can see, she's gonna need a little help. I'll teach her the ways of our trade, but I want to make sure that she has a safe place to sleep every night and a good post every day. Now be off.
You're so wonderful, and I'm so happy.
Lesson number one, don't be happy. No one is going to give you alms if you're happy. Be sad and miserable.
I'll try, but I don't feel sad and miserable.
Try, anyway. Here comes a lady, and she has money, but she's a real hard customer. I'll let you know when she comes by.
Oh, you don't have to. I can tell by her footsteps. Kind lady, alms, please. Would you be so kind as to help me? Alms, please. Would you be so kind as to help me? Alms, please.
There you are, my child.
Oh, God bless you, kind lady. Alms, please.
little Margaret.
Oh, thank you, kind lady. Arms, please. Arms, please. Margaret! Margaret, it's me, Eleanor.
Oh, Eleanor, I'm so glad to hear your voice.
I've been looking all over for you. You've got a place for us to stay.
Where is it?
Joseph, the carpenter. He said we could stay in his stable.
His stable?
There's lots of hay.
Oh, his stable. I'm going to spend the night. I'm going to spend the night in his stable.
Well, it's better than being out in a storm. What is so unhappy about?
I'm just so glad we have a place to stay, and that God is going to let me once again be just like Jesus.
All right, come on, let's go.
I'm glad I have those rags to keep you dry, and those saddle blankets should keep you warm.
Joseph, you're so kind. I'm so happy. Thank you, God.
Thank you, God? Thank Joseph. It's his stable, and he's letting us stay here.
Joseph, I thank you, too. But God comes first, because it was God that led Joseph to say yes.
Yes. Yes, little Margaret. Good night, and God bless you.
Oh, he has. He has.
How did you know that God had talked to Joseph?
Because Joseph must be a very good and kind man to listen to you. And the Lord loves kind people. And kind people love the Lord. So it's true. The Lord led Joseph to say yes to you.
Well, seeing as how he agreed with you, maybe you're right. But the Lord wouldn't have time to spare for the likes of me.
Oh, Eleanor, you're so wrong. Just think of the kindness you've showed me. If he hasn't shown you any love, it's because you haven't asked him.
How do you know all these things?
Father Sylvester told me. He told me about the scriptures and about the love of God.
Who's Father Sylvester?
He's a wonderful man. He taught me about the love of Jesus ever since I can remember. I miss him very much. Tried to talk with Jesus.
No, I don't guess they ever had.
Well, all you have to do is believe that he's here. And have great faith in that belief. And talk to him. Just like we're doing.
I don't know how to talk to him. I told you. He wouldn't have any time for the likes of me.
Alan. I've never felt alone with Jesus. He's always been there with me. All you have to do is reach out to him. Just begin by talking with him. Call out his name.
In due course, Margaret was taken in by the poor families. And here, as everywhere else she went, she brought happiness into their midst. Until she had to leave them.
Little Margaret.
The sisters at the convent have asked me to join them.
Is little Margaret going to leave us, Grandma?
Yes. Yes, she is.
Little Margaret, don't you like living with us?
Oh, yes, Toadie. I like it very much. But the Lord has found a new place for me to live. Besides, I've been such a burden to your mother and father.
No, Margaret. You've not been any trouble at all. You've been a pleasure. And I hate to see you go. But I know life at the convent will be much better for you.
Sister Margaret, we all know that silence is golden, but really you could be more sociable at mealtimes. Don't you think? I guess you don't.
Margaret, Sister Margaret, if you could only tell me why you don't talk to the other sisters, your sisters. Are you unhappy here, Margaret?
No, Mother, I'm not unhappy at all. I'm only observing the rules that I accepted when I became a member of this convent.
Sister Margaret, one must be sociable.
The rules say that silence should be kept in the dining room and in the corridors. If one doesn't intend to keep these rules, then they shouldn't agree to accept them.
We are living in the 14th century. These rules were made centuries ago. One must adjust. Otherwise, I'm afraid I shall have to ask you to leave.
Father, they are very unhappy with me here. I am trying to live by the rules of this convent, but I am making everyone, including Mother Rosanna, angry with me. I have been told that I must conform to their way of living, or else leave. Father, am I so wrong?
Margaret, we discussed this before, and I told you then that what you are doing is pleasing to the Lord. That is still true. The only question is whether or not you are strong enough to carry through your belief, your faith.
Dear Jesus, what am I to do? You say one thing, and our society says another. Maybe Mother Rosanna is right when she says conform to the present. But Jesus, you are ever present. You don't change, and you don't compromise. Oh, Jesus, I am confused. Who does Mother Rosanna speak for? You or the world and its comforts? You were never comfortable. Oh, Lord, don't let me weaken for the sake of a comfortable bed and more food than my body needs. Give me the strength and the courage to follow you. Help me to find a way to serve you.
I guess you heard that the convent had to dismiss that little crippled beggar.
Strange, isn't it? The little one seems so religious, always loving and helping.
Maybe she should have stayed on the steps of the church, begging. Well, you know what they say. Put a beggar on horseback.
S-
Certainly, I agree with you. Little Margaret is a very spiritual person, but she's just a girl and also unmarried. You know that the mantellati is for mature women and preferably widows.
Of course I know. But I also know that there's no worry about Margaret ever marrying. I think you could make an exception in this most unusual case. There are several of the mantellati homes that would welcome her with open arms and hearts. She wants to belong.
All right, all right. I will give it some thought.
I'm sure you won't regret it.
Beautiful rose. I've had a rather strange request, and I'd like your advice on the matter, if it's proper for you to give it.
Oh?
I've had a request for little Margaret to be brought into the mantellati. She's neither married, nor is she mature of years, but I'm receiving a little gentle persuasion to make an exception.
Oh?
If she's the troublemaker, people would have us believe, then I'm inclined to say no. But a thought struck me that you, being the confessor at the convent, well, you might be able to throw some light on the subject.
Now you know, you have no right to ask questions about life in that convent.
I know, and I'm sorry. Let's forget it.
Don't move, please. I will say one thing about little Margaret. Her relationship with her maker, her belief in our Lord, and her faith in that belief is strong enough to move the mountain. But the people in the way of the mountain wouldn't like it, would they?
Here. Let me give you a hand in moving this small mountain of trash.
What do you seek?
God's mercy and yours.
Sister Margaret, you are about to become a member of the Order of Saint Dominic. Such a step carries with it the gravest obligations. Henceforth, though you live in the world, you must not be part of it. This religious habit you are about to receive is at once a solemn pledge and a constant reminder that you have dedicated yourself to the service and love of God. Without reserve or conditions other than expressed in the written rule. From now on, sister, your greatest concern must be to serve God and your fellow man out of love of God to the highest degree. The attainment of this ideal is possible only if you make your life one of constant prayer, continual mortification, and cheerful sacrifice. May this spotless white habit you are now to receive be preserved without stain by you until death.
Thank you. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and of the Blessed Virgin Mary, and of Saint Dominic, and in the presence of you, Most Reverend Father, Prior of the Church of Saint Dominic in Città di Castello, I, Sister Margaret, do make my profession And I do promise that henceforth I will live according to the form and rule of the same order of penance of Saint Dominic until death.
At this time, the influential, the rich, began to take her into their homes. In one such home, she made several prophecies, one of which was the death of the head of the family, and that the wife and beautiful young daughter would become members of a religious order. It happened. It's recorded fact. It's also recorded that with a single sweep of her cloak, she extinguished a raging fire that would have destroyed not only the house, but Margaret herself. She healed a cancerous eye with a touch of her hand, and then went to live with one of the first families of the city. This move to the Venturino family became one of the most talked about items of the day. And when Mr. Venturino gave Margaret and his wife permission to visit the prison and care for the sick inmates, tongues really began to wag.
Hey, here come the Mantellata sisters.
Ah, good. Margaret's so much better since they've been coming. Welcome, sister.
Here, Margaret. Will you wash Franco's face?
Oh, bless you. Bless you.
Franco, where are you?
Over here, little sister.
Mm.
the Lord.
The Lord. The Lord. Who is the Lord?
The Lord, God Almighty, is your maker.
You meant it was meant to be like this? Are you stark raving mad?
You might show a little respect. And you can start by keeping your voice down and a civil tongue in your mouth. I know it's been difficult for you, but that's all the more reason for you.
You look so clean, I can almost recognize you. That little girl may not be able to see, but she sure knows.
Angela, look.
Massimo, the little sister.
She's floating in the air.
Massimo, look.
Look if you don't believe me.
She's floating in the air.
Margaret, please pray for me.
Yeah.
No, Margaret! No! No! Father Giovanni! Please, please! Hear me out, and I'm sure you will be glad you did.
Let's hear him out!
Now you are right about the many years passing in the investigation of Albert and Thomas. But one of the qualifications for sainthood is a miracle.
And they are still looking for the miracle. May I remind you that little Margaret in her own lifetime healed the blind with a touch of her hand. She put out fires with her cloak. She healed the sick. She prophesied the future. What more do you want?
My dear Professor, I know, as you know, as all the people gathered in this church know, that Margaret was an exceptional person, but...
That child was crippled and deaf. Dumb, could not make a sound. There is your miracle.
Well, I told you in the beginning, most of you wouldn't believe it, but here she is, over 600 years later, still as uncorruptible as she was during her lifetime. Her skin, her flesh, may look a bit like old shoe leather, but I'm only 65 and mine doesn't look a lot better. Well, you'll make up your own mind. When the touch of her hand gave new life to that crippled, dumb child, Father Giovanni was convinced that she was a saint and she was buried in the church. She is still in the church. And without question, the guardian of all who are handicapped in any way. Charles. Charles. Little Margaret.